Today we are covering stick handling.
So you want to play better hockey, just not being taught the way that you probably should be getting, but you're not, but you see these other players who are getting it and you're like, why can't I be like them? Well, this series is for you.
So stick handling is one of those things that I think is simpler than what is taught out there, but at the same time, a lot of people are good at teaching it and it's pretty well known of what to do, but there are still some distinct differences that I wish were taught that I know now that I wasn't taught originally. I'm going to pull up a Jack Hughes clip that he did on the 32 Thoughts podcast where he explicitly says that he stick handles with his feet.
And I have pretty much the whole blocker side just from like the way my feet are moving. It's almost like stick handling with your feet instead of your hands.
Now, for one, to have a superstar NHLer like that confirming what you've been studying for over 5 years is something special in and of itself, because you finally have someone in major credibility like that articulating exactly the same thing that you've been talking about. So I think that's a terrific step in the right direction for how hockey should be taught. So again, to have someone like Jack Hughes confirming that he explicitly practices that, he intentionally practices that, is very special in and of itself. And let's go over some examples as to what exactly you might mean by that. Because truth be told, all of these players stick handle with their feet. The reason for that is because if you're really good at the base fundamental mechanics from skating, it is going to be much easier to stick handle if you treat the puck as an object that you guide to a certain place rather than something that stays glued onto your blade. This comparison is actually much more in line with dribbling a soccer ball than it is with, say, like having the puck glued to your stick. For one, that's not physically possible because, well, if you tried to put a piece of super glue on your stick on a slippery surface on ice, which is not going to stick to glue of any type, then, well, it's not going to be glued to your stick. But if even if we don't take that literal approach, you will see actually a lot more often than not that the puck is actually being guided and these players are essentially passing the puck to themselves with every single dribble or stick handle that they do. And I think Crosby is a great example of this. If you can see it in a closer view, there's like, here's a little puck tap after he flips it over the stick for a second time. There's another tap forward with his one hand. Yeah, he's not touching it right there. So it's like, well, does he have control of it? It's like, well, it's not glued to a stick in this specific moment. But then he's able to beat the defender and get control of it again for a chance and almost a goal. Something similar happens right here where it's like in this specific frame, even though he goes from backhand to forehand right here, the puck isn't touching his stick in those areas. So it's like, how can it be glued to a stick? Now you might make the case that right here that the puck is actually being guided on his stick, which is like, yes, there are certain physics with certain curves, even though Crosby uses a straight curve. So it's like, we could put that debate aside. It actually doesn't matter about the curve of the stick. It matters about your mechanics. That if you know the physics of the blade, and if you know the physics intuitively of what your body does, then you'll be a very good stick handler. Even then, it's like, even when he gets onto his backhand here, it's like a little tap, a second tap, and then it taps over to his forehand before he makes that little pass. But we can also look at this clip again, and this is a classic one in the dangle by design formula in Crosby's footwork, in addition to what we call the Crosby curl. So you'll notice that to stick handle, watch his right foot. The heel is digging way into the ice. He's in this really wide stance as he makes that deke around the defender. So the pattern here, if we go back to the footwork, is that he does like a little shuffle as soon as he picks up the puck, then a cross under, then gets into a wide stance, anchors off this right foot, and that makes the the deke a lot easier, because you'll see he actually changes his direction with this anchor. If he wasn't doing this anchor, he would be continuing this way. But instead, the anchor allows him to ride the arc of that left foot. This is also a good one, as you'll see that it's foundationally, even though Laine is a taller player than Crosby, he's still using very similar mechanics where he's getting wide. He's changing his direction by, let's say, anchoring. He is anchoring off of that left foot. The only difference is where the puck travels on his stick. So instead of having it pull forward, he's actually pulling it backwards. So there's a difference between those two. And fundamentally, those are the two forehand motions that you would be using with stick handling. But again, it's not that the puck is like tight to his stick. He's still like guiding it. It's not that he's stuck in this position. Like little tap, another tap, goes backwards. In these frames, the only place where a like stiff pull might be argued for, let's say, would be in these frames right here. But again, if we were to take the analysis of looking at something dynamic, watch his footwork. So if this was just a pull with his hands, which he doesn't really, the hands really don't move that much. Compared to pulling it completely to the other side of his body, he's not really doing that. It's more that the footwork makes a deke like this easier, because what the puck is doing is actually following the arc of his right foot in this case. That's the arc within the arc. So again, to look at it one more time, it's the footwork that makes this deke happen. Again, he's looking like he's traveling this way, but then at the very last moment, he moves his hips to face this way. So if stick handling is just with the hands, why do his hips move like this? And why does he get around the player as easily as he does and also make the goal happen like it was nothing? And you'll see, here's another example where footwork actually makes this, the stick handling. So this cross under that McKinnon does is what allows him to get around the defender. It's not him pulling the puck. It's just a little tap. Like if he was pulling the puck, like was traditionally taught, puck's right here, his stick is in the air. It's just a little tap. And it's the same thing right here. Like the puck isn't glued to his stick. Just like he taps a little bit right here, taps it back, and then taps it forward for a shot. But you can see how much his hips are moving too. Remember that he's in the wide stance. If you're in a wide stance, your hips are going to move. Your hips are going to move. And you see this with McKinnon. The white knee, it does blend into the ice, but you can still see it, especially like in this frame. If you look at the black pants on this left foot compared to the white and the blue on his left leg sock, you'll see that the knee keeps flexing and extending, even if it's a little bit. And when you're in a wide stance like this, the only way you can flex and extend the knees efficiently and without any effort is by shifting the hips. So it goes up and down the kinetic chain. If you were standing in a narrow stance, it would be easier to just flex and extend the knees just by themselves without any hip movement or without any lateral hip movement. But you do see this with these guys on every single stick handle they take. And it's because of the wide stance with their hips. Now, one more thing to look at is how much the top hand travels across the hip and how much that elbow moves. So like this is a great clip from Barzell on what's called the floating elbow. So you'll see that actually he's protracted with his shoulders. It's harder to see from a side angle like this. So if we were to get a front on view, obviously that'd be more optimal, but you'll notice, look at his left elbow in this case and all this frame. Again, still like guiding the puck. He's not really concerned about having it completely stuck or glued onto a stick. Yeah, it's off of the stick right here. It just goes and catches it. Right there, it just goes and catches it. It's like he's not really like pulling it. It's more just a simple tap and a guide. This is why, by the way, weighted pucks, weighted sticks, or weighted other objects that you stick handle with do not translate as well as they should to this environment when you're stick handling. This is why it wouldn't make sense to increase the weight of a soccer ball for the same exact reason. The weight's going to be the same regardless. As far as I know, soccer players don't, or footballers, whatever you want to call them, they don't mess around with weighted soccer balls because the technique of dribbling demands that you tap the ball forward and then catch up to it. So if you're tapping something that's heavier than what you traditionally play with, does it really make sense that it would translate as well as,
and coaches have been saying it should?
From what I'm seeing from all these clips and what I've played around with myself, that doesn't actually seem to be the case. Now, you can make the argument, it's like, oh yeah, well, weighted pucks and weighted sticks can increase the strength of your forearms or things like that, to which I say, do that separately. Do it separately in the gym. Don't need to be matched with putting weight on a hockey stick and wasting your time there. So that's why I think the weighted sticks and the weighted pucks and all those other tools are not useful, because it's fundamentally different. Again, going back to soccer analogy, you wouldn't increase the weight of a soccer ball. And if you were to connect the dots and say that stick handling is done with your feet and not with your hands, well, you would have to catch up to the puck in that case if you were stick handling with your feet. So we can put that argument to bed, I think. Anyway, so what are some progressions that I have? Well, to go over some differences with stick handling versus skating, there are four main areas. One is the way that you drag the puck or curl the puck on your forehand, and the way that you drag the puck or punt the puck on your backhand. What you see here with this clip with Crosby is that it goes forward first and then he taps it to his backhand. Within precise puck control, within Train 2.0, this is called a Crosby curl. Now, we just saw the opposite of that with Patrick Laine, where this is called a cane drag, where it goes, instead of going forwards, it goes backwards, like you saw right here. And those are the two main forehand movements. And by the way, this one is distinctly different from a toe drag because it is more game transferable. You will not see players successfully pulling off a traditional toe drag in the highest levels of hockey. They will instead be doing this because it's way more efficient. It forces them to use their footwork to get around objects or other players. So that's what you see with Laine. And the reason it's called a cane drag actually is because Patrick Kane uses it quite a bit. Here's a GoPro example. Yeah, that first frame. It's like it goes backwards. That's not a toe drag as what is traditionally taught. You would need the toe to be like way over the puck, more so than you saw in that first clip here. It's like, well, it's just not happening that much. It's just a little bit of a pickup, but it's like, that's not a full-blown toe drag as was taught. This is way more game transferable. Now, if we go to the backhand clips, full puck Crosby example here, the little putt that you see here is very common. Again, where he's chipping it in the air and then picking it up kind of as a pass to himself. Crosby will do this most commonly, but in a sense, you actually don't need to punt it in the air all the time. Yeah, like even you can consider this backhand tap right here. You can consider that as a punt, even though the puck doesn't go in the air. And same thing with that one where it goes through the legs of the defender, where it's like, you can consider that a punt, even though the puck doesn't go into the air. So that's one of the backhand areas. The other one is where you're actually pulling it backwards, where it's like it briefly does go backwards. Dotsuk was actually really good at this too. You pull it backwards on your backhand and it goes towards your towards your body rather than away from your body, like we saw with Crosby with that punt. Now, obviously, Pedersen doesn't pull it back as far because he's then going into another little cane drag before forcing the defender to lose his balance. But basically, those are the common four. You got Crosby curl, you got cane drag, you got backhand punt, you got backhand pull. And now for some progressions. You first need to get really good at the corkscrew, the anchor, and the soft drag in particular, I think. The corkscrew in particular is the foundational mechanic. And you're going to be in that stance whenever you start stick handling, as we saw with a bunch of the other players right here. But what the anchor and the soft drag do is increase your lateral ability and your lateral deception. Anchors are very good for slowing you down and making a tighter cut, whereas soft drags are better for control and longer distances. You can maybe even slow yourself down with them. They're also good for faking people out. Not that the anchor or the corkscrew don't fake people out. Obviously, it's just the soft drag can lead to a little bit more ambiguity with your footwork. I then also progress people with quick handles in place, getting used to that, which is something that's pretty commonly taught and pretty well known. Although if you look at some of these players more closely, you'll realize again that they have these little swivels and little shifts in their hips for every single stick handle that they take. It's not that they roll the top hand, for instance, it's that their feet and their hips, again, are doing the stick handling. And that takes a little bit of time to free up, but quick handles in place are still very effective and they can work very, very well to unlocking things. Then I have people quick handle with all nine mechanics. So this really hones in that you have to stick handle with your footwork. If you can't stick handle with a cross under, well, it's going to be very hard to control the puck on the ice. Can't stick handle with a 10 and 2. Again, going to be really hard to control the puck on the ice. Same thing for stutters, shuffles, 10 and 2s, anchors, whatever I didn't mention, outside edge rolls, like all of that. And lastly, I have people quick handle at their top speed with all nine mechanics and with all mechanic stacks that I offer. Obviously, mechanic stacks can expand into any other, and as many, like so many different combinations that you think of. And once you're good at that, at top speed with a certain amount of stacks, maybe two or three mechanics together, and then progress into three to five mechanics together, that's where things really start to come together for your puck control. There's also another progression where you do it in tight to the net, which can make us a lot more frightened because we're so close to the goalie, and that's where you're so close to scoring your goal too. But you get really good at that. You get really good at doing all of this in tight to the net. You're going to score a lot more goals because you're going to start faking out the goalie and you're going to have more control of the puck. It's all going to come together, like I said. And if you want to hone these down even further, I'll say it again, the dense methodology, every minute on the minute methodology, is a great way to get lots of reps in a short amount of time or a designated amount of time. That's also a great way to get a lot of reps in and ways to unlock your stick handling that, well, frankly, you've always had. So that is everything I wish I knew about stick handling that I know today and I'm teaching today. I want to thank you all for watching, and I will see you in the next video.